More than a billion people in the world live with some kind of disability. Thanks to advances in medical science, we live longer, but everyone has a right to live well. This means to actively engage in society, to have a meaningful employment, to go to school, to be social with friends and loved ones. Scientists from all disciplines contribute to this. I'm a professor of biomechanics, so I'm interested in the body as a system with muscles that actuate and a brain that controls and sensors all over the place that can detect force and motion and position. As an engineer and a biomechanist, I want to help and empower each person to be as active and mobile as possible. I get to do this at work every day, and they pay me for it. Today, I'm going to focus on walking. Humans were made to move. Evolutionary studies describe how upright, bipedal walking has emerged. Our brains are hardwired to move, but to conserve energy for when we really need it. Small children who are typically developing all learn to walk at about the same age, even though no one really teaches them. People without a disability, if they want to move from one point to another, they can get there in a number of ways. They could sprint or crawl or dance. And if they have a really good reason, they will. Otherwise, people fall back on that same walking pattern and the usual pace because it's the one that requires the fewest number of calories per meter. So this makes walking actually kind of useful because in many ways it's predictable. So we can make simulations with models that have bones and muscles and a very simple neural command to move at a certain pace and use as little energy as possible. In motion, this means using only the muscles you need and only when you need them. These simulations predict a pattern that looks an awful lot like typical walking. So we can see walking as an optimization problem with an infinite number of solutions, and our brain automatically selects among these solutions by prioritizing energy conservation. And so from there, we can start thinking about models that test different hypotheses. For instance, how might the most optimal way of walking be with weakness on, let's say, muscles on one hip? Here, we can see a pattern that is a little more energy demanding than the one I showed you, but for this set of conditions, is now the most optimal. Is it something we need to fix? Not necessarily. For this given set of problems, this is actually a pretty good solution. Maybe we should even look for ways to preserve this ability to compensate, as long as by compensating for one problem, we haven't inadvertently caused other ones, you know, the knee on the other side or the back. So hypothetically, we should be able to simulate walking in a combination of muscle weakness or an inability to flex or extend joints as a way to model some of the symptoms that are common in disability. But this starts to raise interesting new questions. For instance, does everyone necessarily walk in the most efficient way? Maybe not. If you think about having pain in one of your knees, if you start walking, it seems like your priorities might be a little bit different. Conserving energy probably isn't the most important thing all of a sudden. Trying to minimize that pain is. And what is this whole idea of a performance? Is it really that important to walk independently in a pattern that is kind of typical? But for a person with a disability, it might be more important to keep up with friends or to feel stable and not like you're about to fall over, even if it means you change the way you walk or you pick up walking sticks. So, in general terms, on one hand, we have characteristics and symptoms that we can measure on a person: strength, flexibility, pain, BMI. And on the other hand, we have a measurement of their performance that we can define in a few different ways. We would like to be able to connect these dots. Simulation is one way of getting there, but in truth, it can require a fair number of assumptions and simplifications. This is an animation of a research subject in our lab with spinal cord injury. It's very tempting to try to decode each individual deviation and tie it back to a specific symptom or specific characteristic, but as I usually tell my students, people are complicated. So another way that we can approach this is with AI models that are constructed on data from real people with disability. So we measure in real people all of these characteristics I talked about, strength and pain and so on, and we observe their walking performance in our lab. And with enough data, we can start to connect these dots. We can start to quantify just how much one particular factor can affect outcome. And this can be really useful for planning treatments. For instance, we can indicate which, you know, for someone who can strength train, which muscles should they target to maximize their performance improvement? Or will small changes in a characteristic like flexibility or BMI actually have any meaningful outcome improvement? Some of these symptoms and conditions can be addressed with surgery or therapy or medication. Other ones, not so much. For instance, muscle weakness in a completely paralyzed muscle. For that, we would have benefit of an assistive device. So in our group, we are designing robotic exoskeletons that assist and enhance movement. Now, if I say robotic exoskeleton, maybe your mind just conjured up images of sci-fi movies and Avatar and RoboCop and that kind of thing. Large dimension systems that are fully articulating. That technology is by all means really amazing, especially for someone with, let's say, complete paraplegia. But for a person with a walking disability, in many cases, it's just a bit over the top. So we are taking a minimalistic approach where we target a gait disability at one or maybe two joints, and with the correct assistance, a lot of the other joints and body segments tend to kind of work themselves out. We are using a human-in-the-loop approach where we tailor the assistance we give based on the response from the user and their own goals. And in all of our cases, we encourage the user to be actively engaged. We don't want to replace their ability, we want to enhance it. So one specific example is an ankle exoskeleton that is specifically targeted for people who have a drop foot or a steppage gait pattern that's very common after a stroke. This device has motors that are worn around the waist that drive cables that lift up the foot and help during walking to advance the leg and to safely contact the floor and be able to support weight. Motors have an advantage that they can provide a complicated assistance pattern. It also means that the user generally has to carry around motors that might be kind of bulky and kind of noisy, and battery packs that can be kind of expensive, and kind of heavy. So another approach we're using uses springs. In this case, this one behind the ankle. So when you elongate a spring, it stores potential energy. And if you allow it to shorten at the right time, in this case, it can help push the foot off the floor and propel the body forward. This could be useful for someone with weak calf muscles, or really anyone who could use a little push during the day. So we have discussed how one could decode motion to find out causes and effects and how to assist it. But how do we reach the people who really need it? We have a very nice lab at KTH. We have nice equipment, and we can measure with high accuracy motion and forces and muscle activations and metabolic cost while people walk or propel a wheelchair or exercise. We have computational models that can estimate all of those things we can't directly measure, like internal forces. All very useful. but not everyone can make it into a lab like that. So we've been looking into systems that can measure motion in people where they are with limited resources. These can include wearable sensors that can estimate body position, something like one might have on their smartwatch or that are kind of popular in VR games nowadays. We've been testing systems that use multiple smartphones or cameras and a pose estimation to measure motion. These measure motion in the full body in reasonable accuracy. This usually requires streaming videos through some kind of machine learning algorithm that's been trained on a lot of input data. Again, they show a lot of promise, but they generally require tripods, calibration, some tech savvy. So we've been developing a system that uses a single smartphone that's been trained, that has a pose estimation that we've trained in our own lab and our data. And the idea is that one should be able to prop up a phone at home in their own kitchen and with reasonable accuracy measure their motion as a part of a therapy program or just to track their own progress towards their own goals. So we have technology and we have models and we have a connected world nowadays. We can empower each person to be active and to engage, but circling back to these 1+ billion people, well, clinical caregivers across the planet do work wonders with the tools that they have available to them. We, as engineers and innovators, it's our job to deliver tech that is robust and that is sound. It's our job to take advantage of breakthroughs in technology and science, to push the boundaries of what's possible today and make the new state of the art for tomorrow, and to reach everyone that we possibly can. Thank you.